Glyphosate is a common herbicide sprayed on crops to get rid of weeds. It's a weed killer. And it was originally sold by Monsanto under the brand name RoundUp, although nowadays it's sold by a lot of different companies under different brand names. The main question people ask about glyphosate is cancer. Does glyphosate cause cancer? So that's what we're going to focus on today. If you have other questions about glyphosate, let me know below and we can definitely go over them another day. Now, glyphosate works by blocking a specific biochemical pathway that produces some amino acids. And this pathway exists in plants, it exists in microbes as well, but it doesn't exist in humans, interestingly. So maybe this is good news, maybe glyphosate is harmless to humans, since we don't have the pathway that's the target, right? But in science, we always need to test and demonstrate. We can't just assume, because maybe glyphosate affects our microbiome and that harms us somehow, or maybe it has some other effect that we don't expect. So we always need to test. So I went over all the information I could find on glyphosate and cancer, dozens of studies, meta-analyses, reviews, all this hoopla. And I'm going to try to give you a general idea of what's out there, try to give you a sense of the controversies so you can make informed choices, but hopefully not go so mega nerdy that I put you to sleep. We're going to try to hit that sweet spot. I have to say, after going over all this information, I was pretty surprised by what I found, and I learned a lot. By the way, I have zero connections to any of these industries, Monsanto or pesticides or organic agriculture, zero connections, zero preferences, zero conflicts, just going over the evidence and trying to make sense of it. I should also point out that most health organizations out there, most regulating agencies, deem glyphosate to be pretty safe, specifically with regards to the cancer question. And most colleagues that I've talked to were of that opinion as well. But after going over the evidence myself, I'm less convinced. I still have questions. And maybe I'm wrong. That's part of science. You could always be wrong, but it always hinges on the evidence. So basically, when it comes to glyphosate and cancer, there are three lines of evidence. There's in vitro data, so test tubes or cells in a petri dish, including human cells, and you throw glyphosate on the cells and you see what happens. Then we have lab animal data, so rats or mice or maybe pigs, and you feed them glyphosate and you see if they get more cancer or not. And finally, human data. Humans exposed to glyphosate, do they have more cancer or not? Long story short, the in vitro data and the cell culture data shows that when you throw glyphosate on cells, you can see some changes like DNA damage, for example. As far as the animal data, most studies don't find a link. Most studies do not find an increase in cancer in these animals treated with glyphosate. There are a couple that do find it, but the majority don't. Now, these data are interesting, test tubes or cells or animals. They're important. We always want to carry out those experiments, and we want to look at them. But in my opinion, they're always preliminary. They are suggestions, maybe hypothesis generating, as we call it in nerd speak. But at the end of the day, we want to look at human data because we see this all the time. There's all kinds of things that you can observe in cells or in test tubes or in animals that don't pan out in humans. So at the end of the day, human data reigns supreme. So what data do we have on this question of glyphosate and cancer? We don't have randomized trials. Because we're talking about cancer, it takes many years to develop. Also, there are ethical issues. So running a randomized trial on this question is almost impossible. We may never have them. So we're left with what we call observational data. We observe people with their natural exposure to glyphosate and we see what happens. And there's two main ways that you can do an observational study looking at this question of glyphosate and cancer. One way is you can find people with cancer with the diagnosis of cancer, and then another group that's reasonably matched on most characteristics, except they don't have cancer. And you can ask these two groups of people about their previous histories, their exposure to glyphosate, among other things. So this is called a case control study because you have your cases of cancer and you have your controls. And it's an easier study to do. It's fast. It's relatively cheap. The problem is it's not very convincing. It's not very robust because it has all kinds of biases embedded into it. One group knows they have cancer. The other group is healthy. And when we have a cancer diagnosis, especially a rare type of cancer, we tend to rack our brain looking for explanations, right?
And so people who know they have cancer tend to report previous exposures more often, and even things that they associate with cancer, maybe they heard about in the media, they tend to report those things more than people who are healthy and are not thinking about cancer.
So we call that a reporting bias. The other way to do the study is what we call a cohort study. It's less bias in that sense. You take a large group of people, nobody has a diagnosis of cancer, they are exposed to different levels of glyphosate in their normal lives, and then you follow them over many years and you wait for some of them to develop the cancers that you're interested in. And then you see if those that develop the cancer are the ones that had the higher exposure to glyphosate to begin with. So this is more robust, it's more convincing scientifically, it's also a lot harder, massive number of people, takes forever, costs a lot of money, etc. So the bottom line here is that the case-controlled studies, we have a few of those, and several of them show a link between glyphosate exposure and this type of cancer called NHL. It's not the hockey league, it's a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, a specific type of a blood cancer. And then the cohort studies, they generally don't find that link. They fail to replicate this suggested link from the case controls. We also have a number of meta-analyses. So a meta-analysis is a study that takes a number of existing studies and kind of averages them together. And we have several that suggest this link with NHL. The problem is generally what they do is they'll take 5 or 6 or 10 case controls and they'll usually take one cohort study and average everything. And they find a signal of NHL, but of course this is kind of averaging, and because the number of case controls is higher, it kind of leans in that direction. But in science, when we have case control studies and cohort studies disagreeing, in general, we go with the cohort studies because they're more robust, they're more convincing, right? So we generally lean in that direction if they're solid. The problem is the cohort studies here are not particularly solid. First of all, there's very few cohort studies on this question. Second, there's quite a few kinks with these cohorts. So for example, in 2005, one cohort was published and it showed no link to most cancers, no link to NHL, so contradicted the case controls, but it suggested a possible link to a different type of blood cancer called multiple myeloma. Now, several scientists have come out criticizing this study. There's a whole back and forth. It's a big soap opera. Several studies have suggested that this is an artifact of how they treated the data, how they analyzed it. And if you analyze it differently, and according to them, in a better way, that result, that link to multiple myeloma, goes away. And in fact, in support of this idea, there is a later analysis that came out looking at the same population, same group of people, but followed much longer. So the 2005 analysis followed this crowd for about 7 years, and this later analysis followed them for about 17 years.
And they saw no link between glyphosate and most cancers, or NHL, or multiple myeloma.
So it contradicted that previous cohort, and it trumps that previous cohort, because it's a longer analysis, more robust, but it suggested a possible link with yet another type of blood cancer, acute myeloid leukemia. And finally, last example I'll give you guys. There's a study that took 3 different cohorts and pooled them together. And this is good. We always want to look at this type of study, looking at kind of big picture that increases our confidence.
And they found no link to most cancers, no link to total NHL, no link to multiple myeloma either.
They don't refer to acute myeloid leukemia specifically,
but they found a possible link to a subtype of NHL, a specific type of lymphoma.
It wasn't quite statistically significant. It was what we call borderline significant. It was right on the edge of when it crosses into statistical significance. So that's quite a few kinks, and I have questions. I have lingering concerns. Now, on one hand, there's a lot of inconsistency. Each cohort's a different answer. Also, the statistics on these cohorts are really funky.
So what these studies look like is they'll have a long table looking at every type of cancer, right?
So it'll be breast cancer, prostate cancer, colorectal, lung, blah, 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 20 or 30 different types of cancer. Everything or almost everything on the table is negative. So no link, no link, no link, no link. And then there'll be one thing at the bottom with a significant association or a suggested link or borderline.
But what happens when you do multiple comparisons like that is it raises the odds statistically of you finding a false positive,
Are you finding a result that is not real? And so there are standard ways in statistics that we adjust for this, that we treat the data corrections. But most of these cohort studies don't use those corrections, right? And some of these studies even say in the text, we didn't apply the correction. And if you apply the correction, that result that we reported that linked to that type of cancer goes away. So it's like, so yeah, these results have more holes than Swiss cheese. And when I see people on social media saying, no, glyphosate causes cancer, we know that. It's really hard to take that seriously. Basically, I think they haven't looked at the evidence or they haven't really looked into it properly and they heard something and they repeated it. But on the other hand, things that concern me a little is it's always the same general type of cancer, this general umbrella of blood cancers. And if it was a completely random false positive, shouldn't it be random cancers? This is a little weird. Also, in some studies, we see a bit of a dose-dependent effect. So the higher the exposure, the higher the risk. So these are things that I find a little concerning. I'm not aware of a great explanation for this. Another question I have, these cohorts we've been talking about, they're not looking at people eating foods from crops that were treated with glyphosate, which is the question that most of us want to answer. These are looking at farmers. It's what we call occupational exposure. So these are people who that work with glyphosate. They mix glyphosate. They spray the glyphosate. So they're exposed to large amounts all the time. So maybe studies will pick up some signals that you don't see in someone who doesn't work with glyphosate. But also, I think these farmers wear protective equipment and maybe actually swallowing some amount of glyphosate. Maybe that has a different physiological effect from inhaling and pulverizing around you. I don't know. It's just a lot of questions. Maybe it's completely safe. I'm entirely open to that. Actually, I hope it's completely safe and doesn't cause cancer of any kind. I just don't see a sufficiently strong body of evidence in human beings for me to be confident about that. That's all. And again, I am a bit of an outlier on this. As I said in the beginning, several colleagues that I talked to, I'm not talking about gurus on social media, right, that just do kind of fear-mongering content or look at things superficially. I'm talking about people that have strong scientific backgrounds, that read things, that look into things. And most of the people that I talked to were pretty convinced that this is safe and there's not much risk of cancer there. So I encourage you guys to triangulate anything I'm saying, triangulate with these other sources. Maybe I'm wrong. You make your own informed choice. In fact, I'll link below some of this content of colleagues who I think have a bit of a different view. The other part of this whole story is when we look at these regulating agencies, these international health agencies, they're largely aligned on this question, but not 100%. So almost every single major international health agency is on the side of glyphosate being safe and not being carcinogenic. This includes the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, the EFSA, the European Food Safety Authority, the FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, Health Canada, etc. So we're talking about organizations from North America, South America, Europe, some from Asia. The only major exception is the IARC, International Agency for Research on Cancer. They classify glyphosate as probably carcinogenic to humans. So why does the IARC stand out? One factor I've seen brought up is that they look mainly at the in vitro and the animal data, not so much the human data. And in fact, when this classification came out, it was 2015, I believe, so 10 years ago. And several of the cohorts that we've covered in this video were not published at the time. So this is one argument. They looked at fewer data and especially fewer human data. Another thing is that the IARC generally looks at theoretical risk. Could this molecule, could this compound, could this product theoretically cause cancer in humans in any amount, in any circumstance? And most of these other agencies look at real risk in the real world. Is glyphosate causing cancer as it's utilized in the amounts that we are exposed to? So could it cause cancer versus does it cause cancer? Is it causing cancer? Kind of two different ways to look at it. Okay, so what do we do with all this in real life, right? One question that I think is very reasonable is to say, well, if we have issues, if we have uncertainty, why don't we just play safe and avoid glyphosate? I think that could be a reasonable strategy if we have alternatives that are demonstrably healthier. Because unless you grow everything you eat in your backyard and you control it entirely, if it's not grown with glyphosate, it's going to be grown in some other pesticide. And even stuff from organic agriculture, they use their own pesticides. And I'm not aware of any pesticide that has been shown, demonstrated scientifically, to be healthier than glyphosate. So I would be cautious making a random decision. The other thing I should bring up is that these agencies have established safety thresholds that we want to stay under for exposure to glyphosate. And the quantifications of the amounts that we're exposed to are overwhelmingly way, way lower than that. Sometimes it's like orders of magnitude lower than those safety thresholds. So that's relevant. Now, the safety thresholds are established based on this type of data with animals, for example. So I have lingering questions. Could there be something that happens in a human that doesn't reflect these tests in the animals? I'm not 100% sure. Speaking of making random decisions and deciding out of fear, one problem with having this type of very honest discussion and showing you guys the uncertainties and the kinks is that people are often scared of uncertainty. And so some people end up being scared of this possibility of glyphosate and end up avoiding anything that might be contaminated. Some people say, oh, so I'll just eat fewer fruits and vegetables to avoid any possible contamination. And that makes zero sense because we have 1,000 times more evidence and stronger evidence for the benefits of fruits and vegetables, including links to lower risks of cancer, than we have for anything pertaining to glyphosate, any of these lingering concerns. Also important to understand, glyphosate is not used indiscriminately on every crop. It's mainly corn, soy, and canola. Those are the main ones that are edible. There's a couple others, but these are the three big ones that are treated with glyphosate. And when we look at the evidence, the scientific evidence for health effect of these foods, we mostly see benefit, including as far as cancer. So soy, famously, if anything, is linked to lower risks of cancer, breast cancer, for example. Canola, we have videos looking at canola, canola oil specifically, and any link I found to cancer, it's usually lower risk of cancer mortality, for example, for people who cook with canola oil. So I personally don't avoid any of these foods. That's my strategy based on what I've seen, because I'm looking at big picture. I have the health data of the effect of eating with the food. The uncertainty about the glyphosate doesn't change that. I do wash my fruits and vegetables before I eat them. And in general, this has been my strategy so far with the data I've seen. Now, can we increase our certainty? How can we learn more and be more confident in any direction the data goes, right? We want to get more cohort studies. In an ideal world, we want to have cohort studies looking at actual exposure of actual human intake of glyphosate. The problem is it's really hard to quantify how much glyphosate the person is eating. One way to get around it is to look at glyphosate levels in the urine or levels of metabolites, some molecules that glyphosate can be broken down into in the urine as well. So I found one study, small and preliminary, but interesting, where they looked at the levels of one of these metabolic breakdowns of glyphosate in the urine, and people with higher amounts of that had higher risks of breast cancer. Again, it's a case control, so grain of salt, but I think it's an interesting result and an interesting approach that I'd love to see more data on. Another caveat to bear in mind is this byproduct that they measured is called AMPA, and it can be from degradation of glyphosate, but it can also come from breakdown of other stuff like detergents and things like that. So it's not specific to glyphosate. Even the glyphosate itself, when measured in the urine, is not specific to intake because we can get glyphosate in through inhalation or through even skin contact. There's some evidence indicating that does happen. So the glyphosate in someone's urine isn't necessarily the glyphosate they ate. It's kind of total exposure. But I think it's an interesting line of evidence and something I'd like to see more data on in the future. So that's an honest look at this question. As always, I'll keep digging. If I find any meaningful new data, I'll update you guys in any direction. In the meantime, here's a video on soy and its health effects, and here's one on canola oil and the health effects of eating that. A lot of questions around that. Check those out. I'll see you in there. Bye-bye.